the biologist for your area here. I'll be talking to you today about coyotes and our relationship with coyotes and how to keep them wild. So I work for Mass Wildlife. It's the Massachusetts Division of Fish and Wildlife. The mission of Mass Wildlife is to protect all lands and conserve our natural heritage of species. So that's all fish, wildlife, conserving snakes, amphibians, mammals, game species, non-game species, and all the plants that help create that ecosystem. So Mass Wildlife does manage for coyotes. So we manage, we make sure that all of our species are a natural, renewable, sustainable resource, and we treat them as such. So coyotes can be used for multiple purposes, for hunting purposes, for pelts, for clothing, things like that. And we make sure that we manage hunting in a way that it can be a constant, renewable resource. We regulate through hunting and trapping. Help regulate animal control agents, and we help to teach the public. So coyotes are a valuable species, ecologically, intrinsically, educationally, and recreationally. So what does that mean? So ecologically, coyotes are really important to decrease the small mammal numbers. So mice and rats, voles, things like that, that also carry Lyme disease and other illnesses. Yeah, can you guys hear me? Is this okay, or would you like a microphone? It's hard to hear in the back. I can also push this forward, this visual. Here in Massachusetts, that was not always the case. Prior to humans Mecca, and deforested a lot of landscape for agricultural reasons. They extirpated or they killed off wolves because of fear of predators, but also there's a lot of bounties on wolves and cougars. So once they killed almost the entire population of wolves and they deforested the area, it allowed coyotes to expand their range. So while wolves were present, they actually kind of kept down the coyote population in other areas. They consistently compete with each other, and wolves tend to kill or keep away those coyotes. And today, because of that, they're found in almost every ecoregion, except for the northern part of Alaska there. So let's talk about coyote distribution in Massachusetts. So I'm sure people here in the older cohort, probably when they're kids, never saw a coyote. Probably never heard them. It wasn't very common, especially out east, to ever have any mention of them. So in 59, the distribution, so the reports that we've gotten were in yellow. Can you see that yellow compared to the green there? So it was kind of scattered, random, not many observations at all. Then in 1980, we had more reports, and it's coming from western Massachusetts for the most part. Go a little further on to 1990. It was almost in every part of Massachusetts except for really around Boston and all those really dense urban areas. And today they are present and observed and accounted for all over Massachusetts except for the islands. So let's take a talk about coyotes. Coyotes, the scientific name is Canis lachens, and that actually means barking dog. They're also considered the song dog, and you heard at the very beginning all the sounds that they make, which surprises to most people aren't that many coyotes are involved in those vocalizations. It sounds like a pack, a large pack that you can learn. Coyotes have a very little bit of wolf DNA. As coyotes were moving northeast and southeast, when they moved northeast, they came in contact with some of the very, very low density populations that actually existed during that time of wolves. So even though humans had extirpated most areas of wolves, the northern area of Michigan actually had some wolves still present. So the wolf DNA that is in our eastern species, subspecies of coyote, is very, very, very small. And it's actually been attributed to the Michigan wolves. They did DNA testing, and that small percent. So not necessarily coy wolves, because it's such a small percent of wolf, but there's also domestic dog in coyote DNA, eastern coyote DNA also. So a physical description. So coyotes are about like the size of a medium-sized dog. They're not very large. Females range from 33 to 40 pounds in Massachusetts. Males 34 to 47. That's pretty small. And once in a while, and it's very exceptional that we'll get a coyote that's 55 to 60 range. That's a very, very large coyote, and it's extremely rare. And even that is smaller than my lab. And then as you can see here, the pelts, there's a variety of colors. So I have a couple examples here. They've come in this nice, this typical grizzle. You know, you see where there's black, that black back. And that's very typical coyotes. But then you get like this beautiful blonde. See how beautiful that is? Once in a while, you'll actually get a red. And it's almost as red as a red fox. Really beautiful. So it comes in a variety, also all black. So color is kind of hard to distinguish coyote from other wildlife or other species because it is so variable. So the coyote life cycle, February through March is the prime breeding time for coyotes. That's when coyotes that are coming into their breeding season or their first time ever breeding through sexual maturity, or is that they're able to move around and find their home range, really set their territory. So right now is the beginning of breeding season. So they tend to be extremely territorial, and we'll talk about that more later on in this. But they get extremely territorial. They become more visible through people as they're moving, trying to set their territory. Actually, my husband and I were hiking around last weekend, and you could see the signs. They'll still do the leg lift, like your dog probably does, and they'll scent, you know, hydrants or poles or whatever. Coyotes do the same thing. They'll scent mark their own territory. So that's what they're doing now, setting territories. April and May, so a gestation period is about 35 days for coyotes. So that's when, for the younger folks, gestation period is when you become pregnant to when the animal actually has pups. So it's the duration of pregnancy. That's about 35 days. So in the spring, April, early spring, April, May, is when pups will start to be born. And they'll stay in the den for a while until about, you know, maybe about a month. And at that point, they'll actually they'll start to get weaned off from the mother's milk, and they'll start moving out on the landscape. So June, August, they'll start teaching their young how to hunt, how to vocalize. So we'll get a lot of, they'll start hearing a lot of vocalizations in the woods from the young pups that are trying to learn. And then September, November, they'll be dispersing. So either young pups will stay for another year with the alpha pair, which is not very typical. Most often they will disperse. And then, so let's talk about social organization. So for the young ones here, what do you think a coyote pack is made of? Yes. Yep, so there's actually two. There's an alpha pair. So the mom and the dad are both alphas. Anything else? What else is in your family? Pups? Kids? Yes. Next generation? Yeah, so that's what a family is for coyotes. So there's the alpha pair adults and their offspring. And then their pups. So their pups, their newborn pups will be with them always until they disperse. And then sometimes, like I had mentioned, some pups will not disperse. They'll stay until the following year, and then they'll disperse. So they're highly territorial. So this group family will have their territory, and that alpha pair will stay in that territory. So there's that family group, and then there's the dispersing, or the transients. And the transients are kind of hovering around these the territory, the home range, the home territory of this family group, trying to not get into the territory because the coyotes will get killed if they do, or beat off. So they'll try to kind of weave and find their own little area around these territories, try to fit in, try to get any food sources. So home range size really depends on food and food availability. So it varies from region to region. So if you have a rural versus suburban area or urban area, there it tends to be rural areas. So in the Berkshires, there is larger home size or home range size than in suburban areas, because there's a lot more food in suburban areas. There's a lot more bird seed that people put out, trash, compost, garbage, all of that is at high density. There's pets, there's squirrels. Whereas if you go to a rural area, it's a lot more spread out. So home range has to be even larger to make sure that they get all of their food sources for all the seasons all year long. And then transients, they can travel quite a bit. They can constantly move around because they never have home until they finally do establish a home. And an average coyote will go from 7 to 16 miles a day. That's some work. So coyote young average 6 pups in Massachusetts per litter, but they can have anywhere from 1 to 9. That also depends on the success of the mother. Usually as the mothers get older and have consistently more successful. They pups or litters, they tend to have more. And a lot of this has to do with food availability and population. So population or density of animals, of the coyotes. So we talked about weaned after 35 days. So in 6 to 8 months, they'll start to disperse. Some adults or juveniles could stay. Howling and other communication or vocalization. So coyotes are extremely, extremely vocal. They will howl, and they will yip, and they will make a lot of different noises that make them sound like there's a lot of coyotes. And usually it's just the 6 or 5 or 4 individuals in that group. So these vocalizations are communication, just like you would have with your own family or other families, to defend their home range. So they'll bark around their home range, kind of showing this is my home range, no other coyotes are able to come here. They will try to attract a mate during breeding season, and during summer when they're starting to learn how to communicate. And it's not necessarily used for hunting purposes. So coyotes and resources. So when resources are abundant, there is a higher density of coyote. And when there's a high density of coyote, the litter sizes are greater and survival rates increase. When there's scarce resources, we'd assume the opposite, right? So you're going to have lower coyote density. Litter sizes are also going to increase. Pup survival decreases. Number of yearling breeding decreases. So basically, if you're in an area and you're constantly putting food out, feeding wildlife, their home ranges are going to get smaller because they don't need to have that large home range. They can get all their food, everything available in that small area. And their pups, the number of pups that they reproduce will increase, and their survival will increase. So it increases the number of coyotes. And the opposite is true. If you have limited resource available in an urban or suburban environment, the population will decrease. So let's play a little game of fact or fiction. Coyotes only eat meat. Fact or fiction?
Fiction.
Yes. Fiction. So by dentition, so if you were to look at a coyote's teeth, their teeth here, their canines, they, by dentition, they're considered carnivores. But by practice, they're actually opportunistic omnivores. So omnivores mean that they eat everything, meat, nuts, fruit, insects, amphibians, reptiles, they will eat anything they can get their hands on. And they are super opportunistic. So anything that is there, they will try to consume. Coyotes are nocturnal. Fact or fiction? Fiction. Fiction. Coyotes are not nocturnal. Think about all the pictures you've seen of coyotes. Are they during the day or in the night? Day. So actually coyotes are, for this picture right here. So coyotes in urban environments tend to be more nocturnal. And that's where people kind of figured that coyotes are nocturnal, because most people started making these observations and making those assumptions when they're in a suburban or urban environment. So basically, in the urban environment, they are trying to avoid any human disturbances. So what are some human disturbances? Yes.
Police cruisers.
Yes. Noise. Vehicles. Police cruisers. Any people walking on the street. All of these things are disturbances. So they're trying, they prefer not to have those disturbances while hunting, while moving. So they kind of shift to working at night. But if they are continually exposed to disturbances and they see humans as not a threat, if there's no hazing going on, then they're going to see these disturbances as just another part of the day. So then they begin to come out during the day more often, especially if food is available and there's no threat associated with that. Now in rural environments, where I'm from, you can see a coyote cruising during the day and it's not a big deal because there is nobody around. There's no threats. They're gonna hunt, they're going to feed, they're gonna do everything they do during the day if that's the right time to do it, for bulls, for anything else. Coyotes can be difficult to identify, fact or fiction?
Fiction. Very easy to
identify. No. For some people it is very easy to identify. But you would be surprised of how many people call and say that they've seen a fox, or they did see a coyote and it was actually a fox, or it was a dog. Or they've called and said that they've seen a wolf. And it's not the case. Sometimes when critters are running by, here in Massachusetts, it's easy to assume it's going to be a coyote. But there's some things that kind of are key indicators for when you're looking at coyote versus wolf or dog. Wolf and dog have similar characteristics. So coyote has that long pointed snout, and the nose is pretty small. If you look at a dog, a German Shepherd, or a wolf, we don't have any wolves here, but a German Shepherd, they have the shorter snout with more of the larger bulbous nose. Coyotes have those big ears that are pointed. Dogs usually have floppy ears. So it's, once you get comfortable with it, it is very easy to identify. Eastern coyotes are bigger than Western coyotes. On average, Eastern coyotes are larger than Western coyotes. And that's because of that movement east when they bred with wolves. So when wolves were extirpated out of the area, their density was so low that it was out of desperation that a lot of these wolves would choose a coyote for a mate. Because typically now, that doesn't happen, because wolves are able to mate with other wolves in areas where there's wolves present. Here, you can actually see the size difference of the skull. This is the eastern subspecies of coyote, and this is the western subspecies. And there's not much, it's not large difference, but on average, it's about 10-pound difference. The other interesting thing is that sometimes coyotes are considered even larger than they actually are. So I told you earlier that they're about, 30, 45 pounds. And people always call them like, I saw an 80-pound coyote. I'm like, wow, that's a big coyote. But a lot of times it's because you have this big, beautiful fur. So you see all this right now, this time of year, it's prime coat. It's the densest fur, the longest fur. They're mostly all legs. Took the fur away. Look how small they are. Their legs are so long, but their body is so small. And it's because of that fur. And I think the other thing is because of fear. A lot of us have a little bit of a fear of a coyote or any predators. And when you see predators, you automatically think, wow, that thing's huge. Okay. Well, removing coyotes will decrease the overall population. Nice. That's good. That's a good trick, yes. Okay, so what happens when a coyote is removed from a population? So I'll show you. So you remove one. Remember how we're talking about these transients? Well, that transient within a year will move right back in. There's actually a case, I want to say Utah maybe, that there was, or maybe it was Wyoming. There were some coyotes that were on a farm, and the farmer had killed one of the alpha coyotes, the male. Female left her range and actually took back a male to bring him back with her. So that's the case. Either a transient will come in, or one of the other coyotes will move up and become the alphas. So coyotes and mortality. Oops, sorry about that. Okay, so if you have high mortality and decreased competition, it increases the litter size. So does that make sense? High mortality, decreased competition means that they will have, they can actually reproduce and have more pups because those pups will survive in an environment with less coyotes because there's more food available. Get that, that gets a little confusing. And the opposite is true. So if you have low mortality, there's gonna be more, so mortality for hunting, which is not as much as you would get from vehicle or disease. So when you have low mortality, less vehicles, less disease killing these coyotes, you're going to have increased competition for resources. So when there's increased competition for resources, when those resources are limited, they're going to have less pups. So the actual number of reproduced pups decreases. And then the pup survival also decreases because of limited resources. So basically, even if you have a coyote, you know, I sometimes will get calls that people say, I see a coyote, I want this coyote removed. But even if you get that coyote removed, you're gonna have another transient come. And that transient may not always be the best transient. It might be a problem coyote. So if you have, if you're able to haze the coyote and it's a good coyote doing coyote things, it's best just to leave it there. They're always gonna be here. Okay, so if you see a coyote in an urban environment, you should haze them. Approaching the coyote, just kind of like a jump at them, or anything else you can think of. You know, there's the people do whatever they can, throw tennis balls at them. But what you're doing is you're helping to train them. So there is certain circumstances where you don't need a haze. You know, you're here, you're out hiking, and about, you know, 500 yards away, you see a coyote just hunting in the grasses. That coyote doesn't need to be hazed. That's not a coyote that needs to be hazed. A coyote that's in your backyard, looking at your fence, maybe looking at your dog, that coyote needs to be hazed. So, and we'll talk about hazing in much more detail later, how to haze. If a coyote attacks a dog, a human is definitely next.
Yeah.
Fact or fiction?
Fiction.
Fiction. So, dogs and humans have very different pressures on a coyote. So dogs are considered competition for the most part. Larger dogs are considered competition. Smaller dogs might be considered prey. But large dogs, competition, especially right now. You know, I'm sure people are gonna start to hear the news more, and they have been in the last few days, more attacks, increased number of attacks on dogs from coyotes. And a lot of that is because right now they're in the breeding season. They're extremely territorial, and whatever dog is there is considered a competition, especially with the large dogs. This is when a dog is not, or a cat, is not under the direct control of a human. So that dog is not on leash, that dog is roaming around. If a coyote attacks that dog, that is completely normal coyote behavior. That's something that they will do, and that's not cause for alarm. When there is on a leash, that's when you have a very, very bold coyote. So it's really important to keep your dogs on a leash. So when people, there is a study in Colorado that they did the citizen science project, this study, to see how the coyotes behaved when a human was hazing without a dog on the leash and with a dog on the leash, and how that coyote responded. So when humans were hazing and, you know, they were doing whatever they needed to do to haze, and they're by themselves, that coyote either, for the most part, either ran and stopped and looked and kind of went on his way. When there was a dog present, that coyote changed the way that it responded to a haze because of that temptation of competition. So very rarely did the coyote just run. The coyote actually would run, stop and look, you know, or the coyote would only go about 10 feet, stop and look. And a couple times the coyote did not move at all because of that that competition with the dog. So it's super important to train the coyotes that you are a threat, humans are a threat. Fact or fiction? Yes. Yeah, that's a good question. So typically if a coyote is going to go after a dog on a leash, it's a very bold coyote. And I haven't seen any studies specifically on a smaller dog versus a larger dog, but when they're on a leash, it's not for prey purposes, it's usually because of dominance and competition. So yeah, so it's a little different in those circumstances. Whereas if neither of them are on a leash, there's a probably higher chance that the coyote would go after the small dog because of prey purposes. Fact or fiction, many people are concerned or afraid of coyotes. So who here is afraid of coyotes? You can feel free to raise your hand if you feel threatened by a coyote. Yeah, so actually a lot of people really are. We get a lot of calls about coyotes and concerns about children with coyotes around. So it happens to be that they're very, very concerned. So what are people concerned about? Why do we get all these calls from coyotes? So we get concerns about coyotes just being there, just being in the urban environment. People think that they should not be there. Concerned about depredation of livestock, your chickens. Wildlife disease, mange, rabies. And then taking of pets. So why do these conflicts occur? A lot of it is because of human behavior. It's our job to make sure that these things don't occur. So intentional feeding is huge. That's a huge problem. Intentionally feeding any wildlife you should not do. That teaches and trains the animal that humans are associated with food. Humans are not a threat. So you don't want to do this. And this can also, like we talked about, increase density. Increasing density of wildlife is never ever healthy. Artificial density increases are not healthy. That's what attributes to wildlife disease. Basically 0.034% of all coyotes tested in Massachusetts out of 138 that have been submitted. And about only 9% have been positive. 21 coyotes have been submitted, 20% tested positive for rabies. The other problem, habituation. We talked about this. Lack of threats, being just acclimating to human presence, being okay with it. Human associated foods, and food rewards. So that's breaking into a chicken coop and getting that chicken. That's a reward, and they're going to try to get that every time. Bird feeders, huge problem. People don't think coyotes like to eat seed, they do. Garbage and compost. We get a lot of calls about compost. Pet food, pets. So I talked about that adaptability of coyotes. Coyotes will eat whatever is available, anytime. So if there is a lot of cats around, they'll shift their diet to cats. So not only do they have a seasonal shift of food sources from different fruits and nuts and small mammals, but if there's a lot of cats available, they'll eat cats. And then gardens, fruits, and fruit trees. So if you're having problems with coyotes in your area, it's really important to pick up the apples that drop. And I know that sounds crazy, but if you don't want them in your area, you should be picking up the apples or the plums or any fruits that drop. So what is the progression of coyote behavior? What warrants us or you to call Mass Wildlife or an EPO or a police officer or an animal control agent? So it goes from a severe problem of an individual coyote, not at all severe to extremely severe. So anytime that they're just frequenting and moving around your area, that's normal behavior. Nighttime attack on unsupervised, it's a little bold because getting in your area, maybe a fenced-in area. And then daytime attack on unsupervised dogs, that's more bold, but that's still considered normal behavior of a coyote. That coyote should not be removed because of that. Now, if you get a coyote that starts approaching you closely, following you, and not just walking, happens to walk past you, but following you, or physically attacks people, those obviously are human safety issues. When a coyote attacks an animal or a pet on leash close to you, that's an extremely bold coyote. That's something that should be also addressed and called into the police officer immediately or environmental police. So how do we resolve and prevent these conflicts? Yeah. Modify human behavior. That's exactly what we have to do, is remove all human-associated food sources from your home and really work on hazing. So when we talk about eliminating those food sources, remove all bird feeders. I know people love bird feeders, they're great, but there's so many problem animals that we get calls about, like bears and coyotes, that they're just doing their thing, but they're being fed. So they're going to constantly come, and every time they get a food reward, they're gonna be trained to come back to that location because they know it's a consistent food source. Secure your garbages and use compost containers instead of just compost outside. So when I keep saying hazing, and sometimes people will say harassment, but hazing and harassment are different. Hazing is a way of training wildlife, where harassment is really the intent to hurt and harm wildlife. And that is not what we're trying to do. Hazing, if you have dogs, you've done hazing. Anytime your dog jumps on the couch and you don't want him on the couch, you go, hey, get off the couch. And that dog learns not to be on the couch. Or if they're kept in a certain room, you say, don't, you can't bring them in that room. And anything you use for training, that's a type of hazing. Harassment would be, shooting a coyote with a pellet gun for fun, and they're just doing their own thing. That's not right. That's harassment. And that is illegal. So hazing, you could be loud, you could use an air horn, you could do any offensive noises, pots and pans, whistles, whatever you want, but making loud, aggressive, assertive noises. You can throw objects. People have thrown tennis balls. People have had water balloons. Spray hoses or water gun, that's a good one in the yard. You know, if they're coming through yard, you have chickens or dogs, and you don't want them in the area, and you've tried yelling, and you've tried throwing things, and they are still kind of hanging out there, if you have a hose handy, you should use that. And aggressive body language, or looking big, looking intimidating, looking assertive. You can charge towards the animal. One thing, never retreat with your back turned, never run. That's prey instincts, and that's also showing that you are not assertive or bold, and you are not a threat. So what should kids do? So number one, definitely don't approach any dog that you don't know, whether it's any type of canine that you don't know, even a domestic dog, you shouldn't be doing that. We talked about the difference between coyotes, so remember that. You want to make yourselves look big. Open up your jacket. Reach high. Do whatever you can. And get an adult, too. And again, don't run. Just slowly back away. So you can modify the habitat to help prevent coyotes coming in. So you want to cut back brushy areas, places that they could hide for hunting. Brushy areas also harbor very preferred prey species like rabbits and voles, mice. So brush piles, same thing. And you can disturb, eliminate den sites. So sometimes pneumonia rag is really great. So even if coyotes have had their pups, if their den site is disturbed, they will pick up their coyotes and move to a new den site. And typically coyotes will have two den sites. So they will have their main den site, and they'll have already created a potential other den site if something happens with their first one, their preferred. Some people have called about fencing problems. So coyotes jumping over fencing, and that is, they can do that. They can actually reach over, hook the top of the fence, and pull themselves up and jump over. So if you're having any of these problems or you have concerns, there's something that's called a roll bar that they've created for coyotes. And all it is just a bar over bar. So when the coyotes reach up on the bar, it rolls back. So they can't hook and jump over that fence. Contain livestock and pets. All of your chickens should be contained, and your pets should be fenced in. If you want to let your pets out at night, free roaming, they should be fenced in. Electric fence, your fence should be buried. Dogs love to dig, so do coyotes. Keep your house cats indoors. And not only for coyotes, but house cats are known to really knock down the songbird population. Keep dogs leashed and closely supervised. And especially these next few months when these coyotes are territorial, really work on that. Intolerance. So learning about coyotes, what they do, how they survive, and how they want to survive, really try to be tolerable to natural coyote behavior. General presence without nuisance. Howling's really cool. Try to listen. See if you can pick out the different individuals that are creating those yips and those barks and those howls. It's really fun. And then let them pursue their natural food sources. Just don't try to put out your own food sources for them accidentally. So there are problem coyotes, and it's usually just one individual. It's not the whole population. Once in a while it can be a family if it's constant reward and constantly learned and passed down. But there is some times where we need to actually remove coyotes. So it's a direct threat to human safety. Property is damaged. And only when the coyote that's responsible for these issues can be positively identified. You can't just indiscriminately say, all coyotes have to go now. So who can legally take this coyote if it's actually confirmed to be a public threat? So police officers, animal control officers, if they're deputized, so sometimes they'll have they're called ACOs, and they might work for your local police station. Mass environmental police officers, EPOs. Coyote certified problem animal control agents, and then municipal animal control agents, licensed hunters and trappers. You know, if you're really concerned too, you can always have hunters and trappers. They utilize a naturally renewable resource. So anything that these people have to do, they have to obey the discharge setback limitations of roads, so 150 feet away from roads, 500 feet away from the house. If it's a health and public safety issue, that does not need to be the case with police officers or environmental police officers. So if you're a property owner, you do have the right, according to Chapter 131, Section 37, to dispatch an animal. If there's a property damage issue, they have to be in the middle of damaging property, or if there is a problem, if there's an immediate problem in public safety or human safety. And the only people that can do that is an immediate family member or an employee. So, you know, coyotes are taking your gourds or something like that. And that has to be by legal means only. So shooting or trapping, and it has to be within the act. So it's important to know if you have a problem coyote, you should all know that this coyote will have to be dispatched. There is no trapping and moving coyotes to a new location. If there's a problem animal, nobody else wants that problem animal. So it has to be removed. Trapping is really difficult. In the state of Massachusetts since 1996, we are not allowed to use lead pole traps. So that's usually a quick way to trap. That's how all wolves were relocated, with foothold traps. Some of them are very, very friendly. So you have to use a box trap. And understand, canids are extremely, extremely intelligent. Box trap coyotes, good luck. Because at that point, what you're doing is you're creating a food source at your house, because you have to bait them in. And they get close to it and they back away. So it might take a while, but in the midst of you baiting that one problem coyote, you're also baiting all of the other coyotes because they're getting a free meal. So it's not effective and it's not efficient. So these are the lead pole traps I was talking about. This is a snare and that's a foothold trap. And that those are banned. Hunting and firearm restrictions. These are also some legal limits that we just talked about, 550 feet from the road. Artificial light is prohibited for hunting coyotes. And then, of course, you have to follow your own town bylaws and regulations, which can be more strict than the state. And that's all I have. Does anyone have any questions? Coyotes definitely get ticks. They can harbor Lyme disease, those ticks. They can have anaplasmosis, babesiosis. They can have all of those ticks. It's not as common, but absolutely. That's another vector for tick-borne disease. Anything else? Yes?
What happens to a coyote that has mange?
So if a coyote has a healthy immune system, mange it's not necessarily a death sentence. Now, if they don't have a healthy immune system or there's a high density, usually mange usually occurs in artificially high dense areas. So places where people have been feeding, there's a lot of coyotes. Coyotes will get mange. They'll start moving around and spread it. But in the winter, that is a big threat. Because what happens is it's not necessarily the hair loss that's killing them. It's the fact that they have trouble hunting because of hair loss, because they're constantly itching. They have trouble sleeping because of the hair loss. So they have sleep deprivation, they start losing a lot of weight, and they can't keep themselves warm in the winter. So in the winter, sometimes they'll actually freeze to death because of that. Now again, with mange, the only thing you can do and the only humane thing you can do is dispatch that animal if it comes to the point, or just let the animal, I mean, that's part of nature. There's a reason why there's mange, and it's because of a high density situation. So that's another way of kind of nature taking its course, saying it's too high, it's too many individuals in that area, there's disease, helps bring that population down again. But you're not gonna trap them, you can't trap them, and try to give them medication, it's extremely difficult. And you definitely do not wanna put any medication in the environment, because there's a lot of amphibians and some birds that it's actually completely toxic. It's toxic to them, so that would kill them. So you don't wanna try to feed them any medication to treat mange. Anything else? Yes?
I walked the other day at Riley Palmer, so the sightings of cats today were passing. So, also, people have photographed. It's like a dog, another close, kind of like a Alaskan cedar or mountain or something, that's taken up with a pack of the coyotes. They actually, like, two different people have photographed. And the rangers, the cut the rangers, and they said, you know, they're afraid that that particular dog would attack.
Their territory. They see it as a challenge. So typically a dog would be killed by a coyote if there's a threat. But I've not heard of that. No. I mean there's
the rangers have seen it from the people that are on the working on the trails and then two different people that photographed.
I've heard the opposite of a domestic dog taking in coyote or a wolf. Yeah. And they try to have like a wolf that lost she had lost her alpha pair, her alpha male. There was no other wolves around, and she woke up with. She would sleep every day by the cage of a male of a dog. So I've heard that, but a dog going into a coyote pack, I have not heard of. That's interesting. What town is that in?
Well, it's Toxfield, it's with Hamilton.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Absolutely. Like I called the PCR. There's so many, it's like a paradise for loose dogs now. There's only rangers there from Memorial Day to Labor Day actually pumping ahead to this little swimming pool for the kids on the spray bar. And there's nobody there. So the dogs are loose everywhere. My dogs on the beach.
Good.
But like, is that also, well, like, there's tons of pit bulls loose up in the hills. They're just all over the place. Will those dogs, do they feel, you know, that they would take on a coyote, or?
Yeah, there's some dogs that absolutely would go after a coyote. I mean, they're dogs. There's dogs that are trained specifically to hunt coyotes. They're used as a resource for hunting coyotes.
Like state police, I followed it.
Not for Massachusetts, you're not allowed to use dogs.
The only people that can go into those parks are the state police. So the
Montana
police did come in and try to lock up some of these dogs.
Yeah.
You mean in feral?
No.
No.
Like a dog park.
Yeah.
Off leash. They walk in there and they snap the leash and off. They're all over the place in there.
Well, on Mass Wildlife property, you are mandated to have your dog on a leash. And that's part of the reason,
everywhere.
Too.
The signs everywhere.
Yeah.
No leash.
Yeah. That's something that, yeah, you should take up with the.
I did. I called DC. I called the state police.
Like a legal issue. Yeah. Interesting. Anything else? Yep.
I always have a coyote stick because I work in an area where I see them all the time. I don't know if you've ever been out here to Strawberry Field.
I haven't, no.
Okay, there used to be a family of them that lived there. They go between there and Cedar Dale Road.
Yeah.
And stuff. put inside, just in case I do see coyotes at night.
Yeah.
And then I let the police know, and then they come in and they have to clear the area.
Yeah.
But I always keep a coyote stick with me.
Yes, a lot of people will do that too in areas where coyotes frequent.
No, the stick is in case they charge me. If the animal will then eat the stick and not my hand.
Right, yeah, just, yeah, yep. Yeah, some people have stuff like anything that they can throw at or just comfort. Typically they won't come close enough, but just comfort. Something to wave around. Yeah.
And when they have their pups, like I knew in the spring they were having their pups.
Yep.
Because my vet said, you know, stay off those trails and stay on the main avenue part. But like, are they more protective when they're having their pups or when they're breeding?
Oh yeah, they're more protective of their territory when they're breeding. But they're extremely protective of their pups.
So should we like stay off of those trails? I mean, I just completely stay off of them now between the pit bulls loose and the...
Are they denning right next to the trails?
Pardon?
Are they denning right next to the trails?
Well, on the trails though, we have to do these like hills.
So it's mostly, so during the time where the pups are denning, they're protective of their den. So there's gonna be one, you know, usually the alpha female will be in the den with, or around the den with the pups, because she's lactating and they're milking and everything. And the male is out hunting and he's so concerned with hunting, it's usually not too much of a threat. But again, if there's, it's mostly habituation of humans. So if there's resources available, yeah, that dog could be taken, not typically out of challenge, usually. It's usually these couple months. But if they feel threatened, if another dog goes close to the den, absolutely.
And one more question, like, why the state parks? I mean, I would have read the conversation, but there's a lot of state parks. Why aren't they educating people more? Like, why aren't there signs up? They've got those kiosks everywhere, wherever you enter. Why aren't they educating people, like, you know, February and March are your breeding season there? They need to be protected. Because there's packs out there everywhere. I mean, every time you meet somebody on a trail, they say, oh, there's a pack over here or whatever. So why aren't they educating people more?
I don't know. That's a good question. I think maybe some people don't think that people care, you know, or yeah, that's
okay. You like, you know, make a phone call.
Right.
Good question.
Yeah, I never thought of that. That's a good idea. Yeah, at least so they know and maybe it's more threatening. But also you don't want to give the indication to people that say January, February, March breeding season. And then they'll say, okay, well, I'm gonna keep my dogs on leash during those months, but then all the other months are fine. So you also don't want to give the indication or the assumption to people that outside of those months they're fine, because it's not the case either. There's a higher chance of an attack on a dog this time of year, but there's still, your dog can definitely be attacked any time of year. So I it's hard to put something on there and then it might make people might think that they're limited to that time, and that's not the case.
No, because a coyote or whatever, you know,
there's
something wrong with it, whatever. If you have pepper spray,
is
that
anything? Oh yeah, you can get bear spray. Bear spray is great for all wildlife. Yeah, that's great. That's a great idea. Yep.
That's all I consider the coyote.
Yes. Yep. That's a fur bear. What's that?
Is the season set usually combined, or is it a specialized season?
There's specialized trapping seasons and specialized hunting season. Yep.
It's limited in time.
Exactly. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
I don't have to know what it is.
You know, I don't have the regulations on me. I'm not sure. I know right now is still coyote season. I think it started towards the end of... I'm trying to think this year when it started. It started at the end of deer shotgun, I believe. So usually it tries to be associated with the pelt, because it's a fur bearer species. So they try to associate it with that nice winter coat. So a lot of our... Exactly. So that's what they keep it as.
Is there much commercial value in the pelt?
No. Not much. So all
it seems like a wonderful belt.
It's beautiful, yeah. And you guys are all welcome. You know, kids, please, you're welcome to touch this. These are all educational belts. So all of the nails and the The padding is all still here. It's a great way to learn about the pelts, but they are beautiful. And trappers simply trap out of the enjoyment of trapping for fur bearers or harvesting a coyote for the enjoyment of that. People will eat the meat of coyote, and fur is an incredible resource for warmth. I mean, it's better than any type of synthetic warmth that you can really get, to be honest, for the most part. And it doesn't stay wet, it dries really quickly. But no, there's not much value in pet pelts anymore, or fur of any kind, which is why a lot of people are not into trapping anymore. It's one of the other reasons why we have problems with beavers. You know, people, it's just too hard to trap, there's no value.
Too bad it isn't a delicacy.
What's, I know, right? They're cool though, they're beautiful animals, definitely appreciate it.
Does like the deer breeding season correspond with them, so that like, does it pay to see like little ponds?
Oh yes, yes, yeah. If they can
so
find a pond, they will. Massachusetts, usually the first couple weeks of June. Yeah, so yeah, they'll take a fawn. I mean, it's hard. It's harder for coyotes to find a fawn. Remember, when fawns are bedded down, they have no scent. So anytime an animal gets a fawn, it's usually out of luck, or something happened to that fawn where it might be sick, and that sickness is causing a scent, like an infection. But those are really, they're very thorough and constantly cleaning the fawns. So the fawn in the grass, it does not have a scent, and they won't move either. So they'll take a fawn if they approach it, but it's not a big staple of their diet by any means.
In the West, I'm more ready to run it.
Okay.
We call coyotes, call,
yep.
Three of them.
Yep.
And of course, one of them is that way. Can they do that in this state? And can they do that there with archery?
People will call in coyotes. Rabbit call, mice call. Yeah, a lot of people use their mouth. Speak to that mouth calls. Yeah, when you're scaring coyotes, don't use that type of vocalization. Yeah, so, yep, you can use,
Do you know if any limitations for archery?
I don't. For archery deer? Coyotes? Yeah.
Because you could use a crossbow on a coyote. I don't know if you can use a crossbow yet on deer, but they may pass that law.
If there is, if you are injured in a way that you're permanently injured?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.